Ric Burns, James Manders, and Ed Davis.
Thank you, Christina, and thank you, Rick and James, for permitting me to interlocute with you here this evening. What an amazing book, first of all. I think when, for those of us in the documentary world, when we hear companion book, we think, hey, companion book, it's going to be kind of flimsy. This is a genuine magisterial work about our beloved and benighted city. And, you know, a lot has changed, or has it, since we all gathered to celebrate your guys' first 8 episodes and when the book first came out, right after 9/11. So I want to begin just by asking, you know, fundamentally, what has changed in our city since 9/11 and what has not changed?
You know, first of all, I can't imagine a better interlocutor. Glad you're not an electrocutioner. Listen, you know, I think the amazing thing about New York is that, you know, it's not plus ça change. It's more that there are deep, deep themes that run in the city's history. They go right back to the very beginning, and which indeed, with a kind of really kind of obedient narrative force, have just kept right on going. What that means is that it's changing, because change is the constant. And goes back to, I mean, everything changes, but New York in a particularly powerful way, when you take a place which is this kind of, I don't want to say uniquely, but this intensely capitalistic, intensely diverse, and those two qualities create a continually powerful culture of transformation. And when people don't give a shit about the past, they just want to know what's the next thing, what's the next mousetrap, what's the next book, what's new people are coming in, new forms of life. So it's always changing, and so to capitalism and democracy, diversity and commerce, you have to add, you know, a culture of transformation, which, by the way, has always been global. I mean, who is Henry Hudson? You know, he's an agent of a global empire coming here. And so those things have remained remarkably constant, and indeed since 9/11. And indeed 9/11, we weren't planning to do it with some magical prescience, a film about the destruction of the World Trade Center. Who knew? But it turned out to be that in a place in which capitalism and commerce and diversity and globalization were so intensely enshrined, it was kind of idiotic that we had never mentioned a building called the World Trade Center. You know, and as Neil Ferguson said, you know, for all New Yorkers, including us, might have, you could have called the Manhattan Business Center. You know, but no, it's the World Trade Center, and it has a profile, literal and metaphorical, that casts a shadow around the world. And it was iconic, and everybody knew it, whether they'd been here or not, and not everybody who could picture it in mind's eye liked it, or liked what it seemed to stand for. So we did another episode. You know, what part of capitalism, diversity, transformation, and globalization is the rise and fall of the World Trade Center not about? And what we thought was at that moment heralded, the moment of the World Trade Center's collapse and its aftermath, was the beginning of a kind of like a now fully revealed globalization in New York. It had been global for a long time, how about 400 years, but that kind of particularly parochial way in which you could both be in a global center and so go like, you know, everyone's coming here and they'll all become Episcopalian sooner or later. No. This was a truly, truly global place. And so we wanted to, when James and I started,
1893.
No, but I mean for the new
episode. Oh, new, yeah.
When we started to do one
of 2007.
We thought what we want to do is we're going to do a film called The Future of Cities. Mm-hmm. It's very focused on where cities were going in the 21st century, with New York as the preeminent, glorious canary in the mineshaft. And all those issues would come about. Well, and then I'll turn it over to James. Lo and behold, you know, to be sure, capitalism, democracy, diversity, you know, like what hasn't happened, the degree of immigration over the last 20 years makes Ellen's Island seem like a parochial farm in Iowa. And so it's really been changing dramatically. But then also, talking about change, who would have thought, we didn't 10 years ago, the first 20 years of the 21st century would be the most dramatic, dare one say, melodramatic 20 years in the city's history. 9/11, the financial crisis of 2008 going on, Superstorm Sandy, and now this pandemic. All of these crises are global crises. All of them are existential crises. New York has been at the center, sometimes caused it, although nobody went to jail for it, as in the, you know, the financial crisis. And so it turns out, like, wow, with the obedience, with the kind of built-in narrative obedience, which has been there from the start, it just keeps on going, being the same, changing dramatically, and the story gets hair-raisingly more intense.
I think everything Rick said, but I would just add that on the one hand, the crises, and maybe I would say it this way, every theme that we talked about in the first 18 and a half hours feels like it got amped up, so that you wanted immigration, you had Ellis Island, now you have people coming in from 85 countries. You want to talk about globalization, now you have globalization as unimaginable as it would have been to David Rockefeller, let's say, father. And, in every way, it's sort of more of the same. On the other hand, or not on the other hand, but alongside, you might say, a kind of a second line, a baseline almost to it, is a big change, which was that in the 1990s, when we last sort of checked in, a wave was only beginning that has now exploded, and that is the return to cities. That was just starting. It could be felt certainly in parts of New York and many parts of the city, but it's now something that's really taken over and become a defining element of not only New York, but of American culture.
World culture.
But strikingly in the United States, which more than any other place seemed to have made this strategic withdrawal from its urban centers in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, white flight and deindustrialization, all the ways that the energy of the culture seemed to be sucked out of the city, such that when the Brooklyn Dodgers moved to Los Angeles, it just felt like the inevitable thing, because why would they stay in Brooklyn? What was in it for them in Brooklyn? The new thing, the shiny new thing in every possible way was Dodger Stadium off the freeway in Los Angeles. Because freeways were the new thing in Los Angeles, and cities like Los Angeles were the new thing. Who would say that now? I mean, who would say, all the new ballparks, everything now is a transformed version of the dense, centralized urban way of life. And this has been broadly an extraordinary thing, such that New York, which had been basically static in its population for 50 years roughly, suddenly started exploding again in size, and rather almost breathtakingly added 629,000, a net increase of 629,000 people between 2010 and 2020, which is to say, four times more than any other city in absolute numbers. Okay, New York's a big city, so, but pretty much right up there with the fastest growing cities in the United States. It grew at almost 9%, added one in 10 people to its population. And in every possible way, you can feel that energy. On the other hand, it comes with real costs and affordability. If everyone wants to live somewhere, everywhere that those places they want to live are going to get expensive. We see it only in New York, obviously, but every hot city, Boston and San Francisco and Miami and all the hot cities that young people want to come to are expensive. It's so expensive now that it's hurting, and that's certainly true in New York. So it's been fascinating to watch this kind of, for us, in tackling the story, in kind of finding the counterpoint of these different things. Rick has described this very powerful series of waves of crises, response, resilience that have come, and then meanwhile, this kind of extraordinary series of sort of explosions that are going on one way or the other as the whole way of urban life comes back in a way that you could say has arguably not been the case since, let's say, the 1920s, when New York was sort of absolutely the center of the excitement of American life. And for a long time, it seemed to be going away, and now it's returned very dramatically.
Thank you.
But if you think about the pandemic, how do you think, without getting into predictions, but I mean, it does seem like the pandemic combined with the ability to work remotely, the city has not returned to its office buildings in the way that, well, I mean, also we're all still sick and masked. But, you know, has there been sort of a, I think there's a phrase in the book, the centralization of office workers is no longer viable. You know, that was sort of the case after 9/11, where all of a sudden people thought, wait, we shouldn't all gather, or necessary, or desirable. So if it gained 600,000 citizens in the teens, do you think it will gain another 600,000 citizens in the 20s?
I'll jump in on it and then hand it over to Ric, which is that, first of all, we don't know how this is all going to play out, which you and I talked about. We're in a weird transition place where, among other things, the commercial real estate interests of New York have not really accepted the reality of what's happened. And so this has the important consequence they've kept their rents where they were. This will not be sustainable if it continues, just inevitably. The market will not allow it. They're not going to want their space to go empty. They have to pay for the buildings, which are very expensive. So the rents will come down. And when those rents do come down, that will be very interesting. We did a study years ago of tech in New York, and one of the things that we discovered was that one of the reasons that the tech industry exploded in New York in 2011, 2012, those were the kind of big boom years, was because of the 2008-09 financial crisis. There was a huge amount of space that was available for subleasing because all these companies, which in the go-go years of 05, 06, and 07, had taken on all this space, now had nothing to do with it, and basically we're happy to sell it. All around here, around Union Square and Madison Square, little tech companies could rent space they never would have been able to afford. Now, possible that that might happen, or maybe it won't, maybe we'll see. But I can't imagine that once the rents go down, as they will, that will change. Otherwise, as you see through the New York Times, residential rents and prices have gone right back up to where they were. So, plainly, all those tens of thousands of people who ran away have come back, more or less, or new people have come back. There may have been a generational shift. I think some older people sort of decided they could spend more time in the house in New York or wherever. But young folks are coming to take their place. If they hadn't, we would see those rents and prices go down, and they have not at all. So it's hard to say, but here we are.
I think that what you're saying, I totally agree with James. And also, way, I mean, it's easy to say this, but it's true. Christopher Nickel, incredible biographer of Michael Bloomberg and many other people, said, in fact, in an interview for our film, New York's obituary has been written many times and it's never come true. And it's not going to come true this time. The number of times, the sheer number of times in which you went like, that's it, it's screwed. This time, for real. The Great Fire of 1835. Nothing can stand in the Great Fire of 1835. I'm telling you. So let's move upstate. The draft riots. What do you do when, nearly a million enraged and downtrodden Irishmen, women go on a rampart page against, the African American population so that you have for days, for weeks, African Americans and walking north of the train lines to get away from New York City. Well, and you could go on, moment of kind of like sort of seismic disaster after seismic disaster. I moved to New York in 1975. What an idiot. really? Like 8 weeks after the Post headline, before the city dropped dead daily news, who would go to New York then? And if you would have predicted in 19 said, oh, you know what, it's coming back, it was like you were out of your mind. So it's not as if it goes through challenges and then it comes back. Sure, there is resilience to it. But by being often the first and suffering these issues more intensely, remember it didn't start here. Bat died near Wuhan and New York became the epicenter 2 months later. So it became the epicenter very, very quickly. And it also became not the epicenter rather quickly as well. And that ability to that ability, that the inevitability with which New York confronts really existential challenges, very often in its own makings, or that emerge out of the circumstances that come here. You know, it wasn't an army that attacked New York during the draft, right? It was New Yorkers that attacked New York. And they had to bring in the army, you know, the 7th Cavalry to stop it, you know, right after Gettysburg. And so, creating these massive problems, you know, what does that also create? The inevitability or your debt of finding a solution to it. So again and again, New York, you know, finds itself upside down on its canary perch and going, look at you, it's slip. Or we find some way to write this thing. So there's, and it's not that people go, oh, so we'll do what we did last time. No, it's going to be a new different set of challenges. It's not going to be white flight, you know, deindustrialization, this massive kind of, you know, sort of anti-urban, Le Corbusier, Tower in the Park, We Hate Cities movement, which defined the 20th century, the second half of it. It's a new kind of challenge, which other cities, which places really haven't confronted before. What do you do when you have a pandemic? What do you do when you have all these people? And by the way, it's not about population density. It's about overcrowding. There are plenty of incredibly dense places in New York that did not have particularly high pandemic problems. But if you go to Queens, you can see in my basement where you have like 12 families in a basement. That's overcrowding. That's the kind of congestion that kind of breeds it. Upper West Side is just as dense. Upper East Side, just as dense. But you did not have anything like the same problem. So it's not about density. And sooner or later, a way of making, I don't want to say a virtue, but finding, partly out of necessity and partly out of the kind of resilient mother and father of invention that keeps happening in places like New York, you find a way of repurposing, of finding something else. And it's not going to go away. It just, it's really not going to go. It's going to flourish. It's going to come back. And that we can't predict it now is no stranger to me than that I could not convince anybody that I wasn't a complete idiot to move to New York in 1975.
Great. Well, but certain things, I mean, when people, there has been, you know, a growing feeling, oh yeah, but the city has lost its soul, or Manhattan has lost its soul. And the kinds of people who used to flock to the city, or would flock to Manhattan, aren't flocking to Manhattan anymore. Now, they may be flocking to Brooklyn, they may be flocking to Queens, and even the Bronx.
And flock away.
Okay. Let them flock themselves. But, you know, do you think, I mean, not everything swings back and forth always, does it?
I don't think it's swinging back and forth. I think what's happening is there are characteristics of this particular city. Its location. It's one of the three greatest deep water ports in the world. The fact that, you know, it stole the hinterlands of America by building the Erie Canal, and therefore made sure that it wasn't just going to be one of the three great deep water ports, it was going to be really the greatest port in the Western Hemisphere. The fact that having done that, it built this really interesting, extremely dense environment built to planning for the future on a scale that nobody had ever thought about. The grid, it's like 80,000, there's 80 people living in New York in 1811. You know, 80,000 maybe. You know, and you're going to build a grid north of Canal Street that goes all the way up to the tip of Manhattan Island? What's for that? You're just playing around. You know, in 80 years it's filled up. You know, so that there's this, there are the water, the waterways, and even one of the aspects of water right now, which is particularly calamitous for New York. Used to be water was great. We got the deep water port. We got the Erie Canal, so we're the best harbor anywhere. Oh, we have 600 miles of coastline, and most of it's at sea level. Climate change is now drowning everything. What are we going to do? That means it's going to be another one of those moments where New York is going to have to be one of the lead cities in engineering how you live in a world of climate change. So it's not about going back and forth. It's about this series of kind of like, you know, rising to new challenges, which history and environment and time bring, and then going, you know, how do we solve this problem? Mainly because there's no choice. I mean, if there were a choice, who would solve the problem? You know, get somebody else to do it.
Right.
But New York is continuously in a position where there's nobody else to do it. And there's a lot at stake. And not only that, people will say, this is worth it.
It's one of the things I think, that question was one of the things I think we, I wouldn't say we struggled with, but we really had to confront in writing this. This curious thing that there, in the boom years of New York, the last 25 years, the years when it sort of unquestionably sort of set off the shackles of its troubled earlier 25 years, and began grow and bringing in capital and people and all sorts of stuff, there emerged a kind of a library. It's not a book or two or three. It's like a library of books about how New York is dead or going down or dying or it's lost its soul or it's, we bought them all for the, you know, had to read every single one of them. And it's fascinating.
They're good.
And some are good, some are not so good. You know, it's a curious thing. I mean, the intersection of anyone's own experience. Rick is saying that he came to New York as an undergraduate at Columbia College. At the moment, at the nadir of that experience, everyone comes to the city at a certain point, except if you're like me and grew up here, and seeing all these changes, you know, in my own life. Part of it plainly had to do with the unique circumstance that people who arrived from 1970 to 1995 arrived at a diastolic moment when that incredible sucking had gone on, where unique in the city's history, it was the only time, now seen from the retrospective of 2022, it was really the only sustained time when the city did not have the constant pressure of population growth, meaning rents for once went down. Now that was added to that, a very particular situation, which was lower Manhattan, this incredible culture south of 14th Street, which had been the industrial capital of the world, of the United States, as late as the 1920s and 30s, and remained incredibly busy into the 40s and 50s, finally began to empty out the factories and all of that. I've always wondered about this because we read, you know, the regional plan, and it should have started once trucks arrived as the main way to get things around, instead of like ragged and broken and drawn lorries and rail. It should have begun in 1915. But it hung on, and I always think it must have been because the old guys whose companies it was, their fathers had started the company and they hung on, and they were going to keep operating on Spring Street, you know, into the 50s and into the 60s. Why were they going to move to New Jersey? But finally they retired, and their sons or daughters didn't want to take over the business. So thousands of formerly industrial spaces went empty all across Lower Manhattan. And into that vacuum came underground, you know, modern underground culture, and was born in, you know, everything that we love about art, music, and every kind of element of culture, theater, performance, the whole downtown culture grew in this kind of unique vessel that was created by common space of that place at that time. And it went all around the world. People were like, wow, that's cool. You know, CBGBs and, you know, modern art and all that stuff. And they were like, wow, you can rent space there? That's good. And so now, even by the 70s and 80s, it was beginning to be expensive in Soho, and then it began to be expensive everywhere. So yes, there was a very particular situation where if your idea of New York was set in 1978 or 81, then by 2007, it did not look like that anymore. And particularly the places that you remember, as though we were talking about Jeremiah Moss and those guys, you could walk, you know, in the Lower East Side or the East Village or Soho or any of those places, and they were completely changed. And Jane Jacobs' house that she had grown up in, that she had lived in when she wrote The Death and Life of Great American Cities, her little three-story house where she raised her family, because no one else wanted to live there, sold for $3.3 million. And Jane, as we wrote, she saw it all coming in 1960. She called her book The Death and Life of Great American Cities, I think, precisely because she understood when everybody was structured, it was the life and death. Cities looked like they were going down. She went, oh no, it's actually going to go the other way. And she wrote, she said, the greatest destroyer of diversity is not failure, but success. And she wrote that in 61. So she had the most amazing crystal ball. And, you know, then of course, one other thing we have to say, that people get older and they themselves change, and, you know, they have this sort of attitude that the day they stopped going to nightclubs, no one went to nightclubs anymore. But there are lots of people who go to nightclubs. And there are other things too, which is that, you know, it may be that we've talked about many times now, but the explosion of the tech industry in New York. Tech may be the, you know, pop art of the thing is for culture people like us, that's hard to think about. This may be a golden age, which we don't even know that's happening right now, where this incredible arrival of homegrown tech companies, and every major tech company, Walt Disney is building this giant thing over on Hudson Street. And, you know, it might be like Paris in the 20s, and it's just not our tech, it's not our world, it's not CBGB's and Patti Smith, so.
You know, I'll just say, you know, there's a famous New York realtor, David Velazquez, you know, he started, came down to upstate New York, 40 or 50 years ago, very long ago now, you know, bought up all of Soho, sold it out, you know, moved someplace else, and, you know, went across the river, bought up Dumbo, he owned, well, lent his own all of Dumbo, when Dumbo was nothing, yeah, it wasn't that place, sold it all out. So I think that one question to ask about New York's future is to go to David and say, what are you doing, David? You know, like, you know, have you given up on New York? You're just waiting for those prices to go down. And then my guess, I'll let you know, my guess is that Dave's just waiting. He already knows. He's going to watch the prices go down. He's going to watch the prices go down. He's going to move into a whole aisle of them.
Well, that's very hopeful.
Maybe. You're in the bid.
Well, but I mean, I think that we haven't talked that much directly about money and the tremendous divide and the fact that, you know, these huge needles are going up everywhere and no one is actually living full time. And that feels like it didn't happen before. Is that true?
Yeah, not quite in the same way, but, you know, I think that Esther Fuchs, incredible scholar at Columbia, you know, pointed out when we were talking about income inequality, she said it's really important to remember that, you know, income inequality, if you want to go live in a city that does not have much income inequality, you're going to have to go to Detroit. Because as James was saying, you're going to have to go to a place that's not pulling in people from all over. You know, people with very little to no means, people with enormous means, and everything in between. And that has continued to happen. I mean, as those, you know, I just look at those idiotic to me things on, you know, the south side of the park. So like, what the holy hell are those doing there? You know, I hate them, and I'm glad nobody lives there. You know, I would punch the guy in the mouth. But, you know, the fact is that at the same time, it had been rushing all sorts of people from all over with no means, who are, surprise, surprise, finding it very difficult to find places to live. But they do, you know, hence the pandemic problem in houses in Queens and this, you know, this subgrade places in Queens that have 12 families. And so I'm not saying that that's not a real problem. But it's not that there's not an enormous number of people who come here who see this as a place of unusual opportunity. And it's just the ones who we hate most who are building these really kind of ludicrous monstrosities. And I think that is, James is an architect as well as a genius and a great writer and filmmaker. Maybe James, you know, has it ever happened before?
Yes.
Like this?
Yeah, I mean, as we talked about at the end of episode 3, it happened from 1882 or 83 to about 1912, when, and it happened on the side of Central Park, only it was the east side of Central Park, and not the south side of Central Park. The whole stretch of Fifth Avenue from about 50th Street, W.K. Vanderbilt built the chateau on 50th Street and Fifth Avenue, and some writer said, the Vanderbilts have come nobly forth to teach us how millionaires ought to live. And nobody has seen anything like it. And within about 15 or 20 years, the entire stretch from 50th Street up to about 90th Street. If you look at the West Nile, the Cooper Hewitt Museum, that was about the northern edge of this, of a 2.5 mile stretch of one palace after another, mostly gone now. The Frick is still there, and the Cooper Hewitt building is still there, but most of them are gone, replaced by apartment houses, because the income tax came in 1913 actually, and it wasn't really feasible to have the, it wasn't the buildings, it was the staff she needed to maintain those buildings that was just simply unsustainable. But for 30 years, people would come up from the Lower East Side and their fathers and mothers would walk their children along Fifth Avenue, and Robert Stern says it was like a giant, wonderful outdoor museum. It didn't cost anything to look at it. You couldn't go inside the houses, but you could walk by them, and it was sort of to see if you do your homework and you work hard, and you'll live like that. I mean, no one was ever probably going to live like that. But the idea that New York, in those days, what it really had to do with was the fact that, unlike every other American city, which had its own kind of homegrown wealth, the grand avenues of every city had one, or usually great boulevard where the wealthy lived. New York was drawing all of its own people and all of those millionaires from elsewhere, because they had to have a presence in New York. Not to sound too sexist about it, but the way it sort of worked was the millionaire himself had to have access to New York lawyers, New York architects, New York engineers, New York all the business folks, and all the early public relations, all that. You couldn't find that in Cleveland. So you wanted the, and of course, Wall Street. You needed to have a presence on Wall Street. And the wives, if you've been watching the Gilded Age, wanted to be part of the whole scene of the balls and Mrs. Astor's ball and all of that. And so they built second houses. And those second houses were, yes, they lived in them, but only part of the year, similar to now. And they were really for show. And okay, it looks different now. Now it's, you know, 1,000 feet tall and about 25 feet wide, and an apartment on, one apartment per floor. And it's global, and that's the big difference. It relies on money from all over the world, having a presence in New York.
I do want to say, though, I do think there's a difference about this one, the pencils in the sky one, because I think that, you know, these were not just kind of cash boxes, you know, on Fifth Avenue. And they were very much part of a very long sort of Gilded Age kind of centralization. I mean, New York became New York in the 50 years after the Civil War, when suddenly, you know, if you had money anywhere, you lived two places. St. Louis and New York, Cleveland and New York, Chicago and New York. You didn't live, two places, Chicago and St. Louis. So there's that way in which New York was becoming the centralized capital of America, precisely that point. And you know, New York has been that centralized capital ever since, not just nationally, but internationally. And so this particular phenomenon, which is, partly just to have the place, but it really is much more a kind of like a multi-millionaire, multi-billionaire utilitarian expedient, and not part of this very, very large, deep trend of sort of the country, the wealth, and the economic and cultural and social wealth of the country coming to a tremendous focus here. That's not what these billionaires are doing with this pencil thing. So I just think that that's a different part of the story.
Yeah, and people aren't bringing people up and giving them grand architectural tours of those.
Well, not us.
It's hard to imagine anybody saying, work hard, one day we'll be here.
Although,
I shouldn't say that.
Yeah, people.
So, there's that great Fran Lewis line quote, which is, New York is now, what is it? New York is now a city made for people who don't like New York. To what extent do you think that you know, the changes that you've talked about and the irreconcilable tensions we were talking about this afternoon beforehand, like, first of all, what are those irreconcilable tensions as you see them, and where is it going? And you know, maybe the reins will swing back, and maybe I shouldn't worry so much about my daughters, and they'll be fine, and they'll end up in Manhattan, and not one of the other boroughs where I'll have to travel. see them. But seriously, let's talk about the irreconcilable tensions in the city these days.
I mean, Fran Lindwitz is the most curmudgeonly person in the world. And I love her for that. Please. And, she said once, the West is not the place of greatest opportunity. The West is a place of great opportunity if you want to be a rancher. But what if you don't? New York is a place of great opportunity. So, right, a place now that, people who don't like cities come. I'm not quite sure I agree with her on that. I think we're in a particular phase. I mean, it's one thing when two jets smash into the World Trade Center. You have like a cataclysmic event that takes place really in an hour and 35 minutes and then sort of like reverberates for decades. This is, as many people pointed out, a slow motion 9/11. And we're in the midst of it. And unlike 130-minute, an hour and a half 9/11, this is one which has its own kind of particular hypnagogic, very complicated experience. We're all in it. It's very difficult. Hideous immediate catastrophes are hideous and they're immediate and they're catastrophic. But they have the virtue of being over at least where the rubber meets the road, and then you're dealing with the aftermath. Where's the aftermath? It's like catastrophe and its aftermath are so sutured together in this case. When will we be out of it? And so I think that is, not uniquely, but very, very unusual. That's a defining aspect of this particular moment. And I, as someone who has, suffered sort of psychological issues during my life, I remember I went from the time of 20 until maybe about 25, really suffering. High function, but really going through one of those phases where I began to have panic attacks, every kind of time I moved, and not for that reason. And I thought, I'm not going to, is this sustainable? I wish I were like who I used to be, but I'm not. And I came to Columbia, I did very, very well, one year passed after another. The same way, will this ever end? And in a certain moment, I was sent off to Cambridge because it was a good boys' school. I had to say by about 1980, it's different. There was no sudden on. It's not the same thing. I suspect we're in a kind of situation in New York where answers to questions, desperate though we may be, as I was then, have one, are not going to come to us quickly. But they're going to come to us in an evolutionary way, and in a moment, it's going to be very hard to predict. We're going to be like, you know what? We're not in pandemic mode anymore.
Well, I think that when Fran said that, I think I know what she's talking about. Obviously, and it's about all the things that we're discussing. We talked about this great sort of push away from cities and then the great push back. Well, that takes many forms. One of the forms it takes is simple. People like to visit cities more than they used to. And they would like to visit New York above all. So that New York returned to being the most popular visitor destination, tourist destination in the United States, beating out Orlando. Which is why she doesn't like it, because that's part of it. Because all these tourists were coming from elsewhere with their tourist style, and they walk too slowly and blah, blah, blah. But more insidiously, the people who this was new, the new generation coming into the city, starting in the 90s, had grown up in the suburbs. That was something new. That was, they had grown up, their parents had gotten out of the city very, very deliberately, to have a backyard and have their kids not have to grow up on the streets. And a surprise, surprise, it turned out the kids wanted to be on the street, so to speak, and didn't want the backyard. The backyard was boring, as Jane Jacobs and other people pointed out, that the children didn't get to make that decision. The parents decided for them that it was more wholesome to have a backyard, but there were exciting things about being in a city. So a whole new generation moved back, and they were not New Yorkers or urbanites. And that, I think, is even, and I mean, there were, it's reflected in ways that are subtle and not so subtle. If you feel like there are all these buildings everywhere, these new big apartment house buildings everywhere, one of the things that is, there we go, not even thinking of those guys, I'm just thinking of, because that's, you know, there's seven of them, and they have about 100 apartments each. Right. They're not really responsible for the cost of right. New York apartment of real estate. They're just the most obvious, absurd sign of a certain kind of thing. The real reason for the expense of New York is just all the middle class professional people that are living in New York. Tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, living in those glass buildings, those condominium buildings that we see elsewhere. One of them, there are a lot of apartments in them, but here's the thing that hardly anybody talks about. One of the reasons they feel so big, the apartments have gotten bigger. When I was in the, remembering the 70s and 80s, New York apartments were, new New York apartments were small, because it was sort of like you didn't really raise a family in New York and you were sort of trading off, but the Leibowitz people, brought their suburban values with them, and one of the things they did not want to give up was a lot of square footage and many bedrooms. And so the developers responded. So the number of apartments is one thing, but like the cubic footage of apartments has grown dramatically bigger, which is why the buildings feel bigger. But in every way, what I guess Fran is talking about is a kind of suburban idea of the city. And she and many other people argue that what you see is a suburbanized idea of what New York should be.
To put a cap on it in this respect. You know, I mean, the idea that the problem isn't going to be solved, that it can't be solved, this is where we kind of began. Is so incredibly parochial and kind of short-sighted. You know, Harlem was built as a middle-class, middle-class, housing residential district. Came at the tail end of a massive building from the 1890s, 1900s. Beautiful, beautiful rows after townhouses, and then there was the panic. It was the panic of 1907. You know, it boom, the bottom fell out of the real estate market. It then became the place where many poorer people, in particular people of color, came. Okay, so fast forward from 1907 to 1950, 1960. Harlem's over. You know, it's always going to be a poor place. I wish I could over. You can never, nothing can ever, and that's not true. Nothing can ever lift out of this degree of poverty, collective, and loneliness. How could it not going to change? That's like a ludicrous, parochial idea. You know, I mean, Harlem, Bed-Stuy, the Bronx. You know, last time I looked, the Bronx is not burning. It's booming. And so you reach these points where you're like, no. It's really, really not. Nobody, no sane real estate person. Nobody's going to, well, I guarantee you, no matter what, this place was fucking built to last. That's what happened with Harlem. Those houses were so well built, they could withstand an enormous amount of disuse and landlords who were terrible. And yet, Robert De Niro and Raging Bull, they didn't knock me down. You didn't knock me down, right? They couldn't knock those things down. You can't knock it down because too much bricks and mortar, too much architectural savvy, too much finally just emotional interest is important. So nobody is going, Erie Canal, Schneider Canal. It's the city that's here, that's lasting, the way, as God bless him, Brendan Neal said, the way Venice has lasted. You know, that there's some places in the world that are built to last, and heaven help us, we're in one of those places.
And James,
I just wanted to, what we talked about, I think the issue of affordability and desirability, which are the two sides of the same coin. Like, as we've said, there are 75 cities in the United States that would love to have New York's problem, so-called, that too many people of means want to live there. That's not a problem for a lot of American cities, and that would be a problem they would love to have. New York has the problem, and it is a problem in that it has aspects to it. Affordability, but what I think more broadly we were talking about You know, there's a planner's term, which is called the wicked problems. What's a wicked problem? A wicked problem is a problem which cannot be optimized, for which there's no good, perfect solution. And we discussed a bunch of those, and we struggled and tried to deal with them in the book. And that, the desirability, affordability is one of them. Obviously, policing is another one. That, you know, how do you find the right balance between under-policing and over-policing? You know, we've seen the last 2 years, this great movement against overly aggressive policing. But now we're back to, you know, arguments about, well, we went too far, and now it's, you know, New York City and dangerous again, even though it's about as dangerous as it was in 2004. And I don't really remember anybody remembering that as a famously dangerous year in New York history. But that's one of those just wicked problems. We talked, questions have often come up about preservation and new construction. You know, when my first job is the Landmarks Preservation Commission. I love preservation. But there's no, you know, Adam Gopnik in our interview with him talked about Paris, and Parisians have a phrase. They say, the Venetian, flip on Venice, the Venetian temptation. And it's, you know, to make a museum city that tourists will love, but which is actually not economically energetic because it doesn't have enough new construction. You want new construction, you want economic energy, you have to have new building. And that means some old buildings will get torn down, and it hurts when they get done.
And Fran Woods is going to be pissed off?
And she's going to be pissed off about it, exactly. So that's what I think the irreconcilable things. And I would just say that we tried to present them in their complexity and their contradictory nature, and not shy away from it. But he's not looking for museums.
Great. Well, I got a signal that I should be opening this up to questions from anybody but the person sitting in his chair. Yes.
Question for James. So in terms of the prices of commercial real estate, remember there are no commercial real estate laws as far as prices, and we've seen so many businesses over the last 3 to 5 years who've been here for 30, 40 years completely disappear off the face of our economy. So I don't see what you do, which is that commercial prices are going to come back down soon. The proof is take a look at those residential prices. Over the past year, and I'm talking Manhattan, not just all of New York City, but in Manhattan we've seen rents go up 30-40%. So the middle class that has come to occupy many of these commercial office spaces over the past decades is slowly disappearing because the affordability is just not there anymore. So a lot of these commercial spaces are finding it hard. You know, that's why remote workers are still in place in many cases, because there are just not workers who are willing to pay, cannot afford to pay the rents and afford to live in Manhattan anymore. So the middle class is dissolving and it's getting worse. And then think about it this way. New York is supposedly, what, the most liberal city in New York. Yet we have a Democratic electorate that chose a former police officer as the mayor. And now they're surprised that we're getting returned to things like stop and frisk programs. Now, under de Blasio, who is rightfully criticized for many reasons, the residential rents in New York were the lowest ever in the history of New York City. During his term of office, average increase in rents every year for rent-stabilized apartments, which affect thousands of tenants, were 1, 2, 3%, a couple of years, zero. And now we're looking, the next increase going into, which will be finalized in June, will be like 4 and 6% increases. So New York City has changed, and I don't know about how soon things will get back, if at all, to where they were previously.
Yeah, he's wrong. It's over.
I don't say no. It's different.
There's a lot there. I mean, I'm not sure I even heard a question there, but yes, I mean, I think a lot of these forces are, first of all, New York City has rent stabilization and rent control. No other city in the United States, bigger than Berkeley, California, has it. So that's one thing to remember. Philadelphia, Chicago, Boston, there is no such thing as rent control and rent stabilization. That is a New York phenomenon, and protects 1.1 million units or something like that, so 2 million, 3 million people, and it protects those rents. Yes, it's going up, but let's take a deep breath and see the big picture that, on the whole, New York actually has this amazing thing put in place during World War II, right, by LaGuardia, and never taken, which many cities did, in terms of war, things were out of control. But most other cities in 46 and 47 got rid of it. New York never did. So that's one huge thing. The landlords saying they are struck by inflation like everybody else, and we all know that that's real. So they're claiming, making that claim, and that's what they're talking about there. I don't know. I mean, I don't think the market works perfectly. I think the issue of, you're sort of, we're conflating slightly, commercial real estate, meaning offices and retail on streets, and we've certainly seen a problem way predating the pandemic, in which retail rents were going up too high, and you were getting really a lot of empty spaces, and that has been compounded by the pandemic dramatically. Plainly, that's going to have to find some sort of answer, I don't know, exactly what it's going to be.
Resilience is not going back to the way it was. Resilience in times of massive, massive epochal change is dealing with a set of circumstances, some of which resemble things you've seen before, but in many ways don't, and they seem looming and large, and how the hell are you going to change it? So, even in 1975, I lived on Broadway 110th-ish, I could walk down, from Broadway and 110th down to 73rd and Broadway 101. There weren't shops shut like that. Man, it's like it's like so frightening to see. Block after block after block with nobody renting. So it's not gonna be like that's one aspect, which is multifarious, of this issue. And the resilience that we're gonna be looking at is, how do you deal with this situation? Which, we can look back and be like, well, I guess we can kind of see that, climate change, increased epidemiological disasters are going to cause this kind of thing. We haven't really dealt in America with a combination climate change epidemiological disaster. That's what's new now. All I'm saying is that, well, I can't tell you. There will be a way to find a way, and it won't be a return to the old way. And I guarantee you, in 1931, when people were walking around scratching their head, wondering why the hell had they built this building at the corner of 34th and 5th Avenue, when you have Hoovervilles in Central Park, when there are just as many, stores that are shut, where you have was it a third of New York's labor force out of work? It is a disaster which is just inconceivable, even by these standards. Who can come back from that? And the solution wasn't, we're going to go back to the way it was now. The solution turned out to be this very, very new thing, which is the beginning of a world which we still almost live in, but is itself undergoing change. The beginning of this kind of systemic relationship between the federal government, the New Deal, one New Yorker, FDR, and urban places like New York, par excellence, which are now going to work together, which hadn't happened. There was no FDR, there was no, alphabet soup in 1907, the panic of 1907. The federal government scarcely existed. Now you had this massive arrival of a federal government on a scale which was, just dwarfed anything to come before. We're now living in a really interesting phase in which that, the Roosevelt era, the Depression era, arise of the government has gone through many, many changes. So, just as no one was thinking in 1930, we're gonna have a government that's gonna be giving, the mayor of New York $7 billion in 1930s money to build the Triborough Bridge and rebuild Riverside Park and build that. That would be inconceivable. We don't know in the same level of inconceivability how things are gonna emerge. But it is going to be a new kind of, the resilience will be forward, not retrospective.
Let's hope. That's great. We have time for questions.
Yeah, we can Oh, I teach in Brooklyn on Point Street near the Bergen Street Station. And what I see when I get out, I teach overage, under-accredited students, many of whom have been incarcerated or who have young children. And when I get out of the subway, I'm surrounded by multi-million dollar brownstones, and then I make a right turn, and there's a project in front of where I teach, you know, and in nearby brownstones, there are greengrocers and all kinds of fresh vegetables, and you make a right turn, and you can't find a vegetable. And I think there is no middle class. There just is no middle ground. Everybody who lives near the subway is exclusively white, and everybody I teach, and irony is, I teach social justice and I teach about desegregation. I don't have anybody who isn't dark complexion black in my school. It's like, what, you know? And interestingly, none of the kids have raised that. None of the kids have said, we still don't have desegregation. So what I'm really wondering is, you know, you talk about there's gonna be a new way. One wonders, what might possibly be the new way unless we return to some kind of a vision of an older way where we restore a middle ground at least, you know, and we start to begin to think about, I don't think what's gonna save the city is having these extraordinarily wealthy people and then people who have nothing. If you ask my students, what are you most afraid of? If they write what they're afraid of, they're afraid of being shot. And they're afraid of being shot. And they join gangs, which they can't get rid of for the rest of their lives, for protection. So, and they're right around the corner. I mean, how long is that gonna last? That they're right around the corner from people who own brownstones that cost $6 million. One wonders, you know?
Yeah, I'll just say, I think you're touching on, in my view, and I'll keep this one really short, you know, the defining issue not only of our own time, but of America, full stop, and possibly the world. Which is to say, racial and labor issues that have defined this country from the very beginning. And that we see it every day, bustle. W.E.B. Du Bois called the wages of whiteness, you know, 100 years ago, which is what white people get merely by doing it. Nobody has to pay on the set to get these wages. Opportunities, better education, freedom from all sorts of like predatory and harassing circumstances are relatively so, even if they're dirt poor. This has been something, what you've seen in American history is time and time again, when the wages of whiteness are under threat and the purpose whiteness, you begin to move towards greater and greater polarization in the public sphere, and towards more and more conflict. We are now long since our civil war, the civil war of the 21st century, has already begun. And what you're describing is a situation in which how we're going to be able to solve that. It ain't going to be a return to something. You know, I'm sorry, there was no quote good past. There might have been better things that are better in some respects than there are now. But this kind of completely, this lock grip with which white hegemony has done everything it can, and it's not just America, to control the purposes of whiteness. America is simply like a colonial empire which colonized itself. You know, the real next change, the fire next time, as Jay Baldwin said, is going to be when we find some way, and it ain't going to come easily, where we move out of the post-colonial bullshit, where we move out of this set of circumstances. And we're seeing it across America. Was it just the crazy people with an A-15? I don't think so. So sorry, that was like a small point.
As a resident of that borough across the river, and as you kind of addition too, right, over the last 100 years, obviously the outer boroughs have always been that place for immigrants from across the world or from those of all classes to kind of enter in New York, even when, you know, New York was at a higher income. But of course now all of those boroughs are also going through those same changes, right? So we have traditional immigrant neighborhoods from Williamsburg to Crown Heights and Brooklyn, from Astoria to even Flushing, that are having that same income inequality issues. I'm just wondering from you all, like, how you view that change being the entire city, you know, not just Central Park and Billionaire's Row, not just, you know, the financial district, but now, you know, from the South Bronx to Flushing, to new developments going up in East New York, right? Things are becoming more unaffordable and more unaffordable for, across all five boroughs, and how that impacts the future of the city too.
The ultimate wicked problem. Wicked problem, because in fact, if you do the demographics on it, you'll find that for most of the boroughs, Brooklyn and Queens, the upward put pressure on the rents and prices is not because of the yuppies or whatever they're called nowadays. The ones that catch all the fire, it's immigrants themselves who are taking areas which, you know, no one wanted to live in, or except the elderly people who are still there, but anyone who could got out, which is like, as we said, like many, many American cities. And now people, you know, they immigrant energy has come, and that has brought with it revitalize the boulevards, and suddenly you have great places to eat and all kinds of economic opportunities, and jobs of every kind, and the whole economic machine of those districts. For every one, you know, sort of gentrified, so-called classic gentrified person, there are four immigrants, and that's really creating. What are you going to say? We don't want immigrants. You know, it's like there's no good answer. The only real answer, and it's not an answer, with, you know, I wrote an entire book on housing one time, would be to build more housing. But that raises all kinds of complex problems. And sure, build more housing projects, as long as they're, you know, 20 blocks from us. We don't want it next to our house. And because you don't want to live there knocking, you're not going to build one story and two story little housing. If you want to build housing, they're going to be tall buildings. People don't want tall buildings. And with subsidized housing across the street from them. So where do you build it? We've run out of room, and it's expensive, and we don't even have a system for building it. The way the last two mayors have dealt with the problem now, I guess three, is to say to private developers, okay, we'll let you build what you want to build, and we'll even give you a zoning bonus, as long as you reserve, it used to be 20%, now it's 25% for affordable housing. But if you read the fine print, you'll see their idea of affordable housing is not really, it's nothing like public housing. It's just middle income, you know, it's for, at best, like teachers and firemen, people who are making combined incomes of $125,000 a year, which is okay, not millionaires, but it's not the poor either. So it's a real issue, and I don't think there's any easy solution for it. New York muddles through and, you know, remains appealing to immigrant populations, and the consequences are everything you're talking about.
Should we, did you want to have one more question?
Oh, no, this is, okay.
I just wondered, since you've been studying New York and the past 400 years, is there one, just from an architectural perspective, is there one building or edifice or bridge or something that you just think still floors you as like the most amazing thing for this city?
He knows more about architecture.
Yeah, nobody knows more about architecture. You know, when you read Walt Whitman's Crossing Brooklyn Ferry and imagine a time when there wasn't a Brooklyn Bridge, and that poem was written before the Brooklyn Bridge, it's one of the most beautiful poems ever written. And you look at all the many, many bridges that have been built, and you look at this thing which is stupendously overbuilt, and why with these Gothic arches? It's like, it's the bridge, like John Roebling, you know, what were you thinking? You know, stupid Hegels. And to see this thing there in the middle, still acting, at least in my eye, as the kind of the architectural and, you know, kind of sort of psychic join of our city, not a time I look at it that I'm not almost moved to tears. It's astonishing. It is really, you know, created Greater Manhattan. Before that, you know, in one city, New York, another city, it kind of brought, it was that moment which brought the city that we know together and made the city that we know inevitable. And that it's so overbuilt. You know, as David McCullough, who wrote the book, The Great Bridge, about it, on the basis of which my big brother Ken made his first movie, the Brooklyn Bridge. You know, it's so overbuilt. I don't know what can I get. So I look at that and I go, it gives me a city of complexity and challenge and diversity and conflict. I go, you know, I take a certain kind of deep, deep pleasure in its beauty and comfort in its durability.
I think that's pretty good. I love it all. I look at the Empire State Building every day out my window and I'm reminded of how wonderful it is, even as it sort of gets crowded in. And, you know, those great triptych of the Brooklyn Bridge and Central Park and, you know, these amazing constructions. I read this sort of nasty ass in the New Yorker about, oh, well, Olmsted isn't really the cutting edge anymore. And sort of like, Olmsted will always be the cutting edge of, because he dealt with every, he found, you know, in shapes and forms, a way to address everything we've been talking about, which is how can city gather, somehow manage, despite everything we've discussed, which was as true in 1857, when he started working on his park, as ever, which is just this incredible diverse, not diverse in the nice, easy way, but diverse like really rich and really poor and really different color skins and different religious backgrounds and all of that. And yet, you know, somehow they do get along on the streets of New York, but then the idea of elevating it into this almost utopian landscape, this Arcadian place where everyone would somehow get along, and still do 170 years later, there's nothing we have in common with those people, hardly, except our humanness and our love of nature and our ability to get along. And to this day, it sort of just blows me away that the foresight and imagination and also how well made it is and brilliant and ambitious it was. And you know, it is that thing that New York always, and certainly we saw in the last 20 years, does these just breathtaking things that for a minute kind of make up for all the, what we all know to be, kind of day-to-day nightmarish qualities of the city. It's too busy and too crowded and too everybody's young and everybody and, you know, the horns are honking. And then it just is these moments of grace, which you don't get in places that are day-to-day quieter and seemingly easier and, you know, people are getting along, it's pleasant, but you don't get that those moments of magic.
Fantastic. I think we'll call a halt right there, guys. That was absolutely wonderful. And the book really is, it's a must. It's, I mean, you have to have it on your, you have to have it.
Yeah, our publisher from Knopf are here, and Kathy, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I will say that Kathy Horgan, the extraordinary managing editor at Knopf, who we've had the good fortune of working with Kathy and her colleagues, you know, when she said that about, when was it, maybe almost a year ago, 9 months ago, she said, the new editions here. I said, what do you think, Kathy? Is it great? She goes, it's really heavy.